Hello and welcome to a new video on the Crypto2 YouTube channel in the Basics of Cryptology series. In this video, we want to have a look at block ciphers and in particular on SPN ciphers. SPN stands for Substitution Permutation Network. First, we want to have a look at the basics of substitution permutation networks, and then we want to have a look at two different toy ciphers that are also implemented in Crypto2 that you can easily build by yourself and that you can even perform by hand, as you will see on later slides. As in every video in this series, we start with this slide here, and we know that cryptography is the art of making ciphers and cryptanalysis is the art of breaking ciphers. And this tree here demonstrates where our topic is that we are talking about today. And we are at cryptology, cryptography, modern cryptography, and symmetric ciphers, because substitution permutation networks are symmetric block ciphers. Let's come to the basics of SPN ciphers. SPN ciphers are easy to build block ciphers based on substitution, that's the S, permutation, that's the P, and XOR operations. What all these means, we will see on later slides. And an example of a substitution permutation network that is much more complex than the examples we will have a look in this video is the Advanced Encryption Standard, or short AES. The SPN ciphers work on block of bits in multiple rounds, and each round uses another round key. And substitution permutation networks offer good diffusion and confusion. And these terms were invented by, you already know him from previous videos, Claude Shannon. And what does diffusion and confusion means? Diffusion means that each input bit should influence all output bits. So that means that if you change a bit in the plaintext or ciphertext that you put into the cipher, or you change a single bit in the key, that this should influence all output bits, meaning the outcoming plaintext or ciphertext. And then we have the confusion, and that means that there must be no connection between plaintext and ciphertext bits. Then, of course, our cipher, or our SPN cipher, is built on substitution. And the substitution substitutes a block of bits by another block of bits. And it's implemented with so-called S-boxes. And then we have the permutation. And the permutation changes the position of bits of a given block of bits. And it's implemented with P-boxes. And here you see that even our modern ciphers are built on the most basic terms of cryptology, the substitution, and the permutation here is the transposition. So what is a S-box? The S-box inputs a block of n bits, and in general it outputs a block of n bits. And then we name this a nm S-box. And an S-box maps n input bits to m output bits, for instance, as a lookup table. Here's an example on the right side. You, for instance, input 4 bits here, 0, 1, 1, 1. And this is 7. You just add 1 plus 2 plus 4, this is 7. And then you look in this table here on the position 7. So you have position 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. And in position 7, we have the 12. And then you just output here, or the S-box outputs 12, because this is 1, 2, 4, 8. And 4 and 8 is 12. So what are the requirements on an S-box for SPN ciphers? The first requirement is the completeness. That means that every output bit depends on every input bit. Then we have the requirement which is called avalanche. And that means that changing an input bit means changing half of all output bits on average. This, for instance, is very important that you cannot break such ciphers, for instance, with using heuristics like hill climbing and so on. Then, very important is the non-linearity. That means that no output bit is linear or fine dependent on an input bit. So you cannot create an equation and then compute based on that equation or that linear equation. When you put something into the equation, you get a result and then you get the result of the S-box. That should not be possible. And then, of course, the fourth requirement is correlation immunity, and that means as long as only part of the input bits is known, no conclusion can be drawn about the output bits, and of course vice versa. So when you only know these two bits here, you don't know which four bits will come out, and if you only know these two bits here, you don't know which bits you previously put in. That's the fourth requirement. And for our following examples of SPN ciphers, we need to have invertible S-boxes. What does this mean? Invertible S-box mean you put here in a number, then you get from the S-box the result, and the invert S-box is then an S-box where you put in the number that you obtained here, and you get the original number back. Not every S-box is invertible, you have to design the S-box being invertible. Not every S-box is invertible. For example, if we have the 2 here at 2 positions, then the 0 maps to a 2 and the 1 maps to a 2. But then when you want to create the invertible of the S-box here, then when you put in a 2, you don't know, was it then the 0 here or was it the 1 here? So all the numbers here have to be only once in the S-box, so that this particular S-box here is invertible. And as you can see, this S-box here, every number only is once in that S-box. This S-box here is invertible. So then we come to the P-boxes or permutation boxes. And a permutation box gets as input also a block of n bits, and it outputs a block of m bits. And then, of course, it performs shuffling of these bits. Here's an example. You get in 4 different bits, and then these bits are shuffled around. You see that can easily build also in hardware just by wiring it up. And for instance, this 0 then goes on the second position, this one here on the fourth position, this here on the third, and this on the first position. And this is an easy 4-bit P-box. And P-boxes make the relation between this plaintext and the ciphertext difficult to understand. And we have 3 different types of P-boxes. We have the type compression, the type expansion, and the type straight. So what does expression mean? Expression just means that the input or the number of inputs is higher than the number of outputs. For instance, you have here 4 inputs and only 2 outputs, then we have a compression S-box. Expansion is the opposite of this. You have here fewer inputs than outputs. You have, for instance, here 2 inputs and 4 outputs. And then, of course, we have straight P-boxes. That means you input the same number as your output. For example, here's a 4-4 P-box. And of course, only straight P-boxes are invertible. Then we have the XOR operation. We already had a look at the XOR operation in a previous video, but maybe you don't remember or didn't see the video, so I just explain here right now what an XOR operation is. And the XOR operation inputs also a block of n bits and a round key, for instance, of n bits in the SPN ciphers. And with the SPN cipher, then it outputs a block of n bits. And it, of course, performs a bitwise exclusive OR of a block and the round key. Here's an example. You get in the 0111 here, XOR 0110, and as a result, you get 0001. And how does this work? Here is a table how the XOR operation works. So if you get in 2 ones, you get a 0. If you get a 1 and a 0, you get a 1. If you get a 0 and a 1, you also get a 1. And if you get 2 zeros, you also get a 0. And we have 0 plus 0 is 0. 1 XOR 1 is 0. 1 XOR 1 is 0. 1 XOR 0 is 1. Now let's talk about rounds. Each SPN cipher consists of one or more rounds, and a single round usually consists of, for instance, an XOR, S-box or S-boxes, and a P-box. And SPNs perform multiple of these rounds using different round keys. Here's an example for such a round. You get in the block, you have an XOR here, you get the round key, you XOR it, then you perform the S-boxes here, you have 2 4-bit S-boxes in parallel. These return also 4 bits each, which are 8 bits. Then you have the permutation here, which permutates the output of the S-boxes. And finally, you get a new block here. And round keys are, for instance, derived from a single given key, which is the secret main key. For instance, you have a 32-bit key, and you divide it in 4 8-bit keys. And for deriving round keys from main key, you have so-called key schedules, but the easiest key schedule, for instance, could be, and that is what we use, for instance, with our ciphers here, is you have 32 bits, and then you take the first 8 bits as the first round key, the second 8 bits as the second, the third 8 bits as the third round key, and the fourth 8 bits as the fourth round key. But of course, you can imagine there are way more complex key schedules. And of course, when you want to decrypt using the SPN cipher, you have to reverse a cipher by reversing each round and use the keys in reversed order. So we have this round here, for instance, we perform it three times and you input a block, you get a result, you input it again with a different round key and again, and then you get your final ciphertext. And when you want to decrypt, you have to go backwards. So you put in your ciphertext here, then you reverse the permutation, you use here inverse S boxes, then you insert here the last round key, and then you do this, for instance, three times or four times, depending on your cipher, and then you get back your plaintext here. So let's have a look at our first toy cipher that we have implemented in Crypto 2. And this cipher is so-called Cipher 1 from the book The Block Cipher Companion. That's from Knudsen here. And the cipher is implemented by Christian Bender in Crypto 2 for a differential cryptanalysis tutorial. Maybe you saw the video on what is new in the Crypto 2 2021 release. Then you know that we have now differential cryptanalysis in Crypto 2. And for that differential cryptanalysis, we have some nice toy ciphers. This is the first one implemented by Christian Bender. He implemented it in his master thesis. And the first toy cipher is a symmetric block cipher. Of course, it's an SPN cipher. It has a block size 16 bits, so you get 16 bits plaintext or ciphertext into the cipher. Then you have key size 32-bit, which is two 16-bit round keys. This cipher is a very easy cipher. It has only one round, and its design consists of XOR four times the same S-box in parallel and an XOR again. And on the next slides, we will play with this cipher, and you will see that you can actually perform that cipher by hand. So here we have this cipher. So as I already said, we have an input block, the first XOR with the first round key, then four S-boxes in parallel, then we have a second XOR with the second key, and we have the final output block. We have no permutation here, so actually this is not an SPN, it's just an SN cipher. And we have the S box here as a lookup table. For instance, when you get in four zeros here, it outputs 0110. Or if you put in 1100, you get 1000 here as the output. And this S box is used four times in parallel. And as an example, we put in this plaintext bits here, and we have two different keys, the round key 0 and the round key 1, and we will just go step by step through this cipher now. So we put in the plaintext, we XOR it with the key 0, and then as a result we get this here. This is the intermediate block that we get after the XOR. Then we have to input these bits here into the S boxes. And I will do it one or two times as example. For instance, we have here 1011. We look in our table 1011, and as a result, you get 1101 here. Or 0111. We have here 0111 as example, and we get 1110 here. And we do the same for each S box, and we get this second intermediate block here. Then we have to perform an XOR again. And we XOR with K1. And when we XOR this block here with the K1, we get as a result this output block. And this is a very easy SPN cipher. And our final, as I already said, ciphertext is 0001, 0010, 0001, 1100. We will have a look at the same example in Crypto 2 and check if this is the same. Then we have our second toy cipher in Crypto 2, which is also an SPN network. It's a cipher from the paper Differential Cryptanalysis for a three-round SPN from Muharram Tolga Zakel et al. And here you see the link on to that paper. And it was also implemented by Christian Bender in his master thesis for Crypto 2 for our Differential Cryptanalysis tutorial. And of course, it's also a symmetric block cipher and it's an SPN cipher. It has also a block size of 16 bits, but it has a bigger key size. It has already 64-bit, which are split to four 16-bit round keys. The cipher itself has three rounds, and the design consists of XOR, four times S-box in parallel, permutation, and then in the end, an XOR. And of course, multiple rounds. But we will see this on the next slides. Here's the example, and also you see the cipher here. Sorry, that's a little blurry. And as I already said, we have here the first round, the second round, and the third round. and we have four different keys, K0, K1, K2, and K3. As an example, we use the same plaintext as on the slides before with the first example. Then we have the first same two keys here, and we need two additional round keys. So let's go step by step through the cipher. So again, we put in the plaintext and we XOR with the K0. And as a result, we get here the intermediate block. Then we apply our S boxes. This is a different S box compared to the one that we had before. So let's have a look. We put into the S box 1011. So this is 1011. And as a result, we get 0111. And as a second example, we have 0111. It's 0111. And we get 0101, which is 0101. And the same for the other two S boxes. And of course, all these four S boxes are internally the same S box. Then we have the permutation, and that is more interesting. The permutation we have here, and how you can read this lookup table here. So the bit on position 0, this is the less significant bit, also the bit on the right side here, and it gets mapped to the 0 bit again. So it goes straight through, that is here. Then we have the first bit, and the first bit is here, and it goes to the 13th bit. Then we have the second bit here, and it goes to the 10th bit, and so on. And so the bits are permutated. The next step here is to apply K1. Again, we XOR, then we get this result. Then we apply the S boxes again. Then we apply the permutation again. Then we apply the XOR again, the S box again. And in the last round, you can omit the permutation. First, we have to, of course, apply the XOR, but the permutation can be just easily calculated out of the cipher. And because of that, in the SPN ciphers, you can just omit the last permutation. So now that we know how SPNs work in general, let's have a look at the toy ciphers in Crypto2. We have three tasks. We want to encrypt decrypt using the toy cipher 1 in Crypto2, then we want to encrypt and decrypt using the toy cipher 2 in Crypto2, and of course we want to play a little with that cipher, for instance change the key or change plaintext or ciphertext and have a look how the ciphers behave. And maybe if you're interested, you could try also to implement these ciphers by your own. They are really easily to be implemented, for instance with Java or C#, and then you can, for instance, use Crypto2 to check if you correctly implemented these ciphers. I'm here now in the start center of Crypto2, and I want to show you how you can use toy ciphers in Crypto2, for instance, when you want to implement these by yourself and you want to check if your implementation is correct. I could create workspaces for these ciphers now by myself, but I think this is rather boring, so I already created two workspaces that I will open right now. They are on the desktop. This is the first one is toy cipher 1 for this YouTube video. And here you see the workspace. Here you have the toy cipher component. When you click on the settings, you see you can change between encryption and decryption, and you can change the type of toy cipher. But of course, I let it on cipher 1. And of course, I want to also decrypt, so I copy this toy cipher here and I will close this here. I think it's enough that we see one of these. So this cipher here has a presentation, and as you see, it's the same structure as I already have shown on the slides. And here you could also have a look at some information about the cipher 1 and, for instance, on the S-box lookup table here. But I go back to the cipher itself. And here we have the encryption, and I want to have the decryption also. So I just connect the one cipher with the other. Then we need the same key, of course. And then we copy this here and connect these. This here is ciphertext. This here is plaintext. This is decrypted plaintext. And this here is the plaintext. And we have the key. And what you see here is that we entered the plaintext and the key as bits, as binary data. And this is possible because the string decoders here in Crypto2 support the input format binary. And since these ciphers use so small block sizes and keys and so on, and of course we worked on a bit level in the slides before, it makes sense to also put in the plaintext and the key as bits. And what else can we see here? So we have a 16-bit key here, and we just make a line break here. We have two 16-bit round keys for K0 here and K1. Yeah, and now let's test it. And yeah, and now let's play a little with the plaintext here. So for instance, when we change a bit here, then of course, on average, 50% of the bits should change. The problem with this particular cipher here, and it's so easy, is that when you change a bit here in the first four bits, you only change something on these four bits here, and you only change what happens with this S-box here. The three remaining S-box, they don't get any bits of here, because here's no permutation that permutates bits from the first bits to this. And of course, it's only a single round, so it doesn't change much here. So this cipher is actually not secure. And now let's have a look at the next example here. So we have the toy cipher 2, which is more complex. It has different rounds and so on. So here we have the toy cipher 2, and I do the same, but I will make it small, or I even close it. So let's copy it. Then let's connect these here. Let's make a little more space and connect the key. This can go here. And we copy this, and we connect this here, and we have here ciphertext. Then we have here decrypted plaintext. We have here the plaintext, and this cipher is set to cipher 2 encrypt and cipher 2 decrypt. So let's test it. So we have the same plain text as in the example before. Then we have here a 64-bit key. So as you can see here, we will just make a line break here, and a line break here. So four 16-bit keys. I will make everything a little bigger so that you can see what happens. And as you can see, it's first encrypted to this ciphertext here, and then the decrypted ciphertext is the same. When we change this cipher here to encrypt, we shouldn't get the same ciphertext, plaintext here. And as you can see, it's a different plaintext now. So this cipher, or with this cipher, it makes a difference if you change it to encrypt or to decrypt. So let's change it back to decrypt. And now let's have a look what happens when we change a bit in this cipher here. For instance, let's change a bit in the plaintext here. And then you can see with this cipher here, much more happens. So we can visualize this actually. So we just take this here and we say, please show only differences. And then we press play. And now when we change something, for instance, this here to a zero, you see here many bits change. For instance, we have a change of 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 bits. So on average, 50% of the bits should change. Clearly with this easy ciphers, not every time 50% change, but it should be on average and not every time. So that changes bits in the ciphertext. And why do these change? That's based on the permutation, because when you change a bit here, then you of course change the value of the S-box. And the S-box with the permutation, or the value of the output value of the S-box with this permutation here, goes to every other S-box in the next round here. So changing here a bit changes this, changes all the permutated bits here going to the four S boxes here. And then of course it goes on and on and on. So let's test what happens when we change the key. So let's revert the key or the plaintext to the original one. And now stop and play. And now let's change a bit in the key. For instance, change here a bit in the first key. And you see also that bits at different positions change. Let's go back, let's stop or change another round key, let's change this round key, then only one bit changes, let's change this here, only one changes, but in the early round keys, when you change in the early round key something, then many bits change. So with this particular cipher, that what we already see is that the later keys have not such a big influence on the outcome or of the ciphertext as the only round keys. Yeah. And now, for instance, you could implement these by yourself. You could also create your own SPN ciphers or easy SPN ciphers. You have to keep in mind that the S boxes and the permutation have to be invertible. So that means that the permutation has to be an NN permutation. The S box also has to be an NN S box. And you have to design the S box in a way that you can design an invertible S box. Yeah, and this was everything that I wanted to show you with block ciphers or with SPN ciphers. In later videos, we will have a look at a different construction principle of block ciphers. We will have a look at the Feistel network, which is really interesting. And then we can also use different S-boxes, not only squared S-boxes. Yeah, and I hope I see you in the next videos. So if you like this video, please give a thumbs up. If you don't like it, you know what to do. Give a thumbs down. And yeah, again, thank you very much for watching. If you didn't subscribe to our channel yet, please also subscribe to see new videos. Yeah, see you in the next video.